Hi, welcome back with our discussion on heavy metals. We have dealt with quite a few so far, including arsenic, lead, mercury, copper, iron. There are so many others also, which we will deal with in course of time. But in this session, I thought we should focus on one very notorious heavy metal. And that is often referred to as death metal. A heavy metal with the reputation of being an almost ideal homicidal poison. We will discuss this in the background of a few sensational near-perfect homicides. We are talking of not really this. Death metal sometimes, somebody thinks, refers to a form of rock music, an extreme form of heavy metal music called death metal. I'm just showing you one prominent band's image here, named Slayer. Gives you some sort of an idea, isn't it? Both the image as well as the name of the band as to what kind of music they play. If you are not into rock music, I would suggest that you steer clear of what is called death metal. But if you are a fan of rock music, maybe you can try it out. Let me tell you, however, it is not my cup of tea. That is not a pun, though you may think it is, because one of the cases we will be discussing in relation to the heavy metal today is the so-called teacup poisonous case. We'll come to that later. But as I said, when we refer to death metal in toxicology, we are referring to this particular heavy metal called thallium. Atomic number 81, atomic weight 204. This is a metal that is pretty innocuous to look at. Nothing very distinctive about it. It is just a soft, pliable, grayish metal, as you can see in the image. While the metal itself may not be much of a concern, the derivatives of the salts are very toxic and have got some properties that make them a homicidal poisonous choice. The important salts being thiosulfate, acetate, carbonate, etc. While most of these are odorless and tasteless, not all are water soluble. Some of the common thallium salts, actually, in contrast to what is commonly believed, is not really water soluble, or at least not very easily dissolved in water. But we'll come to those things later. Thallium has got a number of uses, especially in electronics industry. It is also widely used in the glass industry and in some areas of pharmaceuticals, especially in nuclear medicine. There are some situations where diagnosis is achieved with the help of radioisotopes of thallium. Formerly, thallium was also used as a rodenticide, a rat poison, but it is now banned, or supposed to be. I'm not very sure whether you do have thallium salts available in India still for killing rats. It is banned throughout the European Union and many other Western countries, and I think even in India it is in the banned category. But then pesticide industry in our country, unfortunately, is not a very well regulated one, and so there may be some manufacturers who may be using thallium in some rodenticides. Thallium was also used in the past as a depilatory for removing unwanted body hair. When we look at the toxicokinetics of this metal, you will see that most of the thallium salts are readily absorbed by all routes, though gastrointestinal route is the most common in relation to toxicology. Thallium also crosses placenta freely. Very important to remember. So if a pregnant woman is poisoned, that it is very likely the fetus or the child inside her womb is also poisoned. Thallium enters cells by unique process because of its structural similarity to potassium. But unlike potassium, once thallium enters the cells, it is released very slowly. Has a tendency to get concentrated in liver and kidneys, but unlike many other metals, may not be very much highly concentrated in bone. Thallium is certainly excreted in urine and feces, but the rate of excretion is very slow, and thallium can be detected in urine even several months after exposure, a point of great forensic importance. Thallium deposition into hair and nails is also an important route of elimination. These are the important points with regard to toxicokinetics. Coming to clinical features, like all heavy metals, most of the times chronic poisoning, which is a real problem, but thallium is notorious for causing serious manifestations in acute poisoning, and there are several cases recorded of acute exposure resulting in death. We will discuss the symptoms in relation to both acute and chronic poisoning as gastrointestinal, neurological and dermatological manifestations. Though I must point out that in chronic poisoning, neurological symptoms are highly pronounced and can persist for a long time, sometimes unfortunately permanently, even in survival cases. And though the thallium levels may decrease almost to oblivion, the patient may continue to have neurological sequelae. All right, let's look at the important manifestations or signs and symptoms of thallium exposure. GI symptoms, gastrointestinal symptoms, usually begin about 3 to 4 hours post-exposure and take the form of abdominal pain, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, but more frequently constipation, and sometimes there may be stools containing blood, and even vomitus may have blood, but those are rare features. With regard to the neurological manifestations, usually 2 to 5 days after exposure, the most prominent feature is an ascending peripheral neuropathy. Begins as paresthesia, abnormal tingling and numbness kind of sensations, and sometimes feeling of heat or burning, usually beginning in the feet and progressing later on to the hands and fingers. The person often describes his condition as walking on burning coal. He hesitates to put his feet on the ground and walk. And the term burning feet syndrome has come to be almost pathognomonic for thallium poisoning. The extremities, both hands and feet, become very painful and tender in the later stages. Aside from this, there is also distal motor weakness, ataxia or incoordination, tremor. There may also be convulsions in the later stages. Cranial nerve palsies are quite common with the problems relating to gaze or vision. We'll come to that later as a subcategory under neurological features. And there's also confusion, delirium and coma before death takes place. Coming to ocular symptoms, these are very common features that we see in thallium. Diplopia, ptosis, abnormalities of gaze because of cranial nerves being affected, especially cranial nerve 3, 4 and 6. There can also be nystagmus, optic neuropathy and lens opacities. So, ocular manifestations are quite prominent in thallium. Dermatological symptoms, that is symptoms related to skin and related structures like even hair, nails, etc. They take about few days to few weeks to manifest, and it begins usually as a rash. There can be an acne form rash, which can be very severe and can lead to even necrotic lesions, can be very severe. Subsequently, there is anhidrosis because of destruction of sebaceous sweat glands, that is lack of sweating or dryness of skin. That's what is meant by anhidrosis. There can also be painful swelling of the tongue, painful glossitis, even stomatitis. And of course, alopecia is very, very common in Thalia. Hair fall. Sometimes it's very dramatic. And if a person recovers, though hair growth usually again happens, the hair that comes back may not be like the original hair. Mies lines that we discussed in relation to arsenic may also be seen with regard to thallium, that is kind of opaque lines in the nails, especially fingernails. These are the important common manifestations, but don't forget certain other features which are also quite characteristic. Like urine is often greenish in thallium poisoning, a point that is not much highlighted in toxicology texts. There can also be parotid swelling, pancreatic damage, damage to liver and kidneys, and very often there is tachycardia and hypertension. So this is the complete picture of thallium poisoning in acute as well as chronic forms. But as I said, in chronic poisoning, many a time it is the neurological features which are a big problem, and even if survival occurs, there may be permanent neurological sequelae. There can also be permanent problems related to liver, kidney, pancreas, etc. When we come to the diagnosis, the best method is, of course, to detect thallium levels in hair, nails, body fluids like blood, urine, also feces and saliva. You can utilize any of these, as many as possible, and that can lead to a definitive clinical diagnosis of thallium poisoning. The best way to do this diagnostic, you know, kind of thing is to check for 24-hour urine thallium concentration, and the standard method can be used, atomic absorption spectrometry. Radiography, as in the case of all heavy metals, thallium is also radiopaque. So if it's acute ingestion especially, you can make out thallium or thallium salts in the GI tract. Coming to the differential diagnosis, one of the reasons why thallium is a poisonous choice is because the manifestations can resemble an illness. And somebody, you know, who comes across a person who is being poisoned with thallium may not realize that it is a case of poisoning at all, including doctors. And they may start thinking of various other conditions like acute porphyria or thiamine deficiency or Guillain-Barré syndrome or diabetic polyneuritis, botulism, vasculitis, poliomyelitis, even psychosis. Unless the index of suspicion is high, a doctor may miss the diagnosis altogether, may miss thinking that it is thallium which is responsible. So do remember the differential diagnosis. One of the reasons why thallium is a notorious kind of poison that has been used in homicides is because of this. It often mimics natural illness. The other reasons being, of course, thallium is tasteless and odorless, so easily it can be mixed with food or beverages. Though some of the salts are not easily water soluble, so that can be a bit of a problem. Aside from that, almost all the features, all the properties of thallium make for a homicidal poisoner's first choice. With regard to treatment, aside from the usual decontamination procedures, of course, activated charcoal usually does not work, as in the case of most heavy metals. But there are some toxicologists who say that it can be used, and they have found it to be of benefit because thallium is not a genuine kind of metal. So it is to some extent absorbed by activated charcoal and can work. Stomach wash can be done in acute poisoning, and of course, if there is a contamination of clothing, clothing will have to be removed and disposed of, and fresh clothing may have to be given to the patient. But what you need to remember with regard to treatment is the antidote. There is an excellent antidote for thallium, and that's Prussian blue, also sometimes called Berlin blue, which is actually potassium ferric hexacyanoferrate. It can be given orally, and it should be given as soon as possible after the diagnosis has been made. The usual dose is 250 to 300 milligram per kg per day, which approximates to about 10 gram twice daily for an adult. The thallium containing complex is then excreted in the feces, and Prussian blue should be continued until thallium can no longer be detected in the feces. Prussian blue, do remember, is the main treatment modality for thallium, and it is not a very difficult chemical to obtain, at least as far as analytical grade is concerned. Even if pharmaceutical grade thallium is, Prussian blue is not easily available, you can use analytical grade, which is often very pure, and though there can be instances of contamination, much of the time it works. And after all, thallium is a life-threatening, you know, kind of toxic agent, so you need to take a little bit of a risk. So you can contact the laboratories that use this chemical, or you can contact the supplier directly in your area and get hold of this particular chemical, which is an excellent antidote for thallium. Rest of it is mostly symptomatic and supportive measures only. You have to take care of all the other features that I have listed earlier under acute and chronic poisoning, and treat in the usual manner. So that is with regard to treatment, and finally we wind up with the medico-legal importance. Accidental poisoning with thallium, certainly not uncommon, especially occupational exposure in those who are handling thallium, quite possible. Once upon a time, poisoning resulting from rodenticides which contain thallium are common, but today it's not really common at all. Suicidal poisoning, occasionally reported, but what is really a problem with thallium as far as medico-legal or forensic importance is homicidal poisoning. I've already touched upon this. It's called a death metal because it's more or less an ideal kind of homicidal poison. I've given you the reasons also. It is not very difficult to obtain. The salts are mostly odorless and tasteless, can also be mixed fairly easily with food or beverages. And the resulting manifestations mimic some kind of natural illness, so suspicion may not be aroused and analysis may not be all that easy. All kinds of problems as a result of which thallium can be considered as almost an ideal homicidal poison. And that is reflected in some sensational cases. I have picked only two. There are several more. These are two landmark cases. One is Graham Young case, 1971. And the other is George Tripal case, 1988. We'll look at brief facts of each of these cases because they're so important. And all students, medical students, forensic professionals and doctors should know about the potential of toxic agents like thallium when they are used as homicidal agents, as to how sometimes a shrewd or a cunning poisoner can almost get away with it. Graham Young case, I think, exemplifies this a lot. 1971, he was referred to as the teacup poisoner, and these are the brief facts. The full name of this person, Graham Frederick Young, was born in England, 7 September 1947. He had a troubled childhood, but from an early age, for some reason, he was fascinated by poisons and their effects. And in 1961, he in fact started to test various poisons on his own family. Can you believe that? Some of them became violently ill. In 1962, Young's stepmother died from poisoning, and shortly afterwards, his father also became seriously ill, taken to hospital. He was told that he was suffering from antimony poisoning, and actually just one more dose would have killed him. Suspicion fell on Young by this time, and he was sent to a psychiatrist who recommended contacting the police. Young was arrested on 23 May 1962. And he was then sent to a psychiatric hospital because by this time he was diagnosed as suffering from a personality disorder and also perhaps schizophrenia. And so he was admitted there for treatment. And after 9 years, he was released as fully cured or recovered. But in the hospital, Graham Young had utilized his time to study a number of medical texts and improve his knowledge of poisons. And when he came out, he was more or less an expert poisoner. He had even experimented on other inmates in the prison, or I should say psychiatric hospital, sorry, and staff, one of whom in fact died. After his release from the hospital in February 1971, Young began to work in a prominent laboratory in Bovington, close to where he was living, where his ancestral home was. The laboratory in question was John Hadland Laboratories, and this company manufactured thallium bromide iodide infrared lenses, which were used for military purposes. Graham Young became fascinated with thallium, and soon after he began work, his foreman Bob Eagle grew ill and died. Young actually had been making tea for his colleagues in the laboratory, in the industry, very magnanimously. Though his colleagues did not know for what purpose, the purpose was ulterior, of course. He was mixing the thallium in the tea and giving it to various colleagues. This gave rise to a kind of sickness that swept through the entire workplace and was initially mistaken for a virus. It was nicknamed the Bovington bug because the laboratory was located in that place. And these cases of nausea and illness, sometimes severe enough to cause death, were only later attributed to the handiwork of Graham Young. Eagle's successor also sickened after he started work, but he wisely decided to quit. He thought there was something fishy there. And a few months after Eagle's death, another of Young's workmates named Fred Biggs, he grew ill and he was admitted to London National Hospital of Nervous Diseases. But by that time it was too late, and after suffering agony for several weeks, a poor man died. He became Young's fourth and final victim, fortunately. Because by this time, everybody realized at the workplace that an investigation was necessary. Strangely, Young himself appeared to be very helpful to find out who is responsible and even suggested thallium poisoning. Can you believe it? He also told a colleague that his hobby was study of toxic chemicals, almost as if he had a death wish that, you know, people should find out that he was responsible. Young's colleague then went to the police, who uncovered Young's criminal record. And he was arrested on 21 November 1971. At the time of his arrest, police found in his pocket a vial of thallium. And when his home was searched, they found other toxic substances, including antimony and aconitine. They also discovered a detailed diary that Young had kept, noting the doses he had administered, their effects, and whether he was going to allow each person to live or die. Look at the meticulous manner in which this psychopath went about his deadly business. Graham Young was finally convicted and sentenced to life in prison. He died in prison in 1990 of a myocardial infarction. He never really gave reasons as to why he embarked on this very bizarre kind of career, serial killing career. If you are interested, you can watch this film. This is a kind of a parody on the entire case. It's a black comedy, but it is definitely based on Graham Young's case. And this film is called The Young Poisoner's Handbook. If you can get hold of it, watch it. It is pretty entertaining, quite dark, and it has got very good reviews. So that is about the Graham Young case. If we move on to the second and equally notorious case involving thallium, that is the George Tripal case of 1988. This case is sometimes referred as a Coca-Cola poisoning case. The other one, Graham Young, teacup poisoner. This one, Coca-Cola poisoner. Sometimes I think that we should be careful of beverages when there are poisoners around. Now, this is a joke. Anyway, the brief facts of this case are as follows. George Tripal, a professional in chemistry, and his wife moved into their new home in Florida, USA during the early 1980s, and their neighbors comprised the Carr family, who were a little bit of a noisy family. They enjoyed parties and all that. Aside from the couple, there were two sons. And Tripal was not at all happy with their noisy parties and all that, as a result of which a lot of altercations involving both families. And Tripal went to the extent of threatening to kill one of the Carr children because it was so noisy. And the Carrs also received an unsigned letter threatening harm to their family if they did not leave Florida. In October 1988, Mrs. Carr began to suffer from a mysterious illness. She was admitted to hospital and remained there for several days before being discharged. But even after discharge, her condition worsened and she had to be readmitted. In the meanwhile, her two sons also exhibited similar symptoms and had to be transported to the hospital. The attending physician by this time began to suspect poisoning, and he felt that the most likely culprit was thallium based on the symptoms he observed. And within just a single day, thallium poisoning was confirmed by analysis. I'm not really sure by what method, but that's very remarkable. Mrs. Carr's condition, however, worsened and she fell into a coma. She died in March 1988. The two sons remained in the hospital for treatment of thallium poisoning. And in the meanwhile, further testing of other family members were done, and presence of thallium was confirmed in all the surviving family members. In November 1989, officials collected samples from the Carr household to find out the source or the origin of the thallium. They found several empty Coca-Cola bottles which appeared to be suspicious, and they retrieved these bottles and tested them in addition to so many other things that they retrieved from the home. Thallium was detected in the Coca-Cola bottles. Officials knew that 8 bottles of Coca-Cola could not contain thallium as a kind of coincidence, and it must be something that was deliberately done by somebody. Coca-Cola officials who were contacted also claimed that they had not received any kind of report of poisoning or threats related to tampering with their product. In June 1988, the Carrs had received a letter, threatening letter, that they would all die if they did not leave Florida immediately. That letter had been unsigned, but the prosecution linked Tripal to that letter because of comments he made during a police interview. And the police knew that Tripal had the opportunity to enter the Carrs residence because they did not always lock their doors upon leaving the residence. Strange, isn't it, as to how they could leave the house unlocked, even when there were threatening letters. Police also found that Tripal had worked as a chemist in an amphetamine laboratory, an illegal laboratory. And we all know that thallium is a byproduct of amphetamine production. All going to strengthen suspicion that Tripal must be the culprit in this case. In order to further investigate this man, Special Agent Susan Gorick went undercover and she attended a kind of an event called Mensa Murder Weekend that Tripal's wife organized. Both Tripal and his wife are Mensa members. I think some of you at least will know what is Mensa. It's a kind of organization comprising people with very high intellect, very high IQ. That's a main requirement for being a member of Mensa International. It's an organization. And they conduct, you know, events like these, games and all kinds of things which test people's intellect. And in one such event, Tripal wrote a pamphlet for the weekend that described writing a threatening note and then poisoning the recipient of the note. Something that happened actually to the Carr family. And during this same weekend, the undercover agent, Susan Gorek, had contact with Tripal and learned that actually he was planning to sell his Altura's residence and was moving to another place in Florida, Sebring, or maybe even to another state, Virginia. Gorek then arranged to rent Tripal's home in his absence, and in the garage, while searching, the investigators found a bottle containing powdered thallium, the smoking gun, so to speak, clinching the fact that Tripal was the culprit in this particular case. After the discovery of this thallium, Tripal was charged with murder. A subsequent search of Tripal's Sebring home, the new home, in April 1989, turned up further evidence, incriminating evidence in the form of chemistry books and equipment, including information about poisons and, very, very significantly, a novel by Agatha Christie, the famed detective novelist, who had written a novel by name Pale Horse that described using thallium to poison people in a household. By the way, you should really read that book. It's very fascinating. Finally, the police found, as if to clinch everything, a bottle capping machine that could have been used to replace the bottle caps of Coca-Cola bottles after the cap was removed to introduce the poison into the drink. And that is what Tripal did in this case. Tripal was then tried and convicted of murder in 1991. He was sentenced to death. Even today, he is on death row, whether believe it or not, nearly 30 years down the line. Though he has appealed repeatedly and gone to a great extent to say that he is actually innocent and the whole case is false, but no relief has been given to him, and even today Tripal is on death row. Two cases which show you that if investigators had not been very quick to pounce on the fact that it could be poison related to thallium, these cases maybe would have never been solved. Near perfect homicides. Both the Graham Young case as well as Tripal case. There are so many other cases, I think you should take a look. They're all there on the net. When you have time, please go through them and you will see as to why thallium has been called death metal. So that is all for this session. Goodbye.